Welcome to the Baseball Softball Pacific Rim podcast. This is Rob Penny, and I'm super excited to give you Joe Arredondo. He's a dear friend of mine. He's actually the one who introduced me to baseball in American Samoa. But what's unique about Joe is he was one of the few Caucasian in American Samoa that was playing baseball. So it's a very cool story, and we have here Joe sharing about that experience. So I give you Joe Arredondo on this podcast, and I hope you enjoy it. Thanks. Take care.
Hello? Hello, Joe?
Hey, man.
Yo, what's up, man? Rob.
Hey, Rob, how you doing?
How are you, man? Are you good?
Man, Huh?
Is
man,
this a good time or what?
Man, it's an awesome time. Man, I talked to you in a while. How you been?
Good, man. Good. I like it's cool seeing all your pictures of your kids, man, on Facebook.
Man, I appreciate it. Man, you too, man. We got four already, huh?
Yeah.
Twins, like the ones, boys, boys and girls.
Yeah, twins.
You've been busy, Rob.
Yo, so I'm calling because all the the baseball stuff. We grew up playing baseball in Samoa, and I know a lot of the story of us, but I'm sure there's a ton of other people that are unaware of your story. And then also, in large part, unaware of Tony Solace's story. And yeah. I'm very passionate about continuing Tony's legacy, continuing to open up more awareness of the actual sport, because football is big right now in Samoa, and it has been for several years. But I don't think a lot of people knew that baseball was actually massive when we were growing up in American Samoa. So if it's okay, dude, I'd love to ask you some questions. That way the audience, because this is going to be on a podcast, right? Kind of like what I mentioned, messaged briefly, but we're going to publish this on a podcast, on the website, and we're going to let some people just be a part of the story by you telling it, at least your story.
Robert Penny, you ask away, my friend.
Yeah. Dude, so when did you start? Like, how old are you? Let's start from the beginning.
Man, I started. Let me think here. I think I was 7 years old. I just turned seven, and I got a baseball glove for Christmas. And
you guys are living in Utule still?
Yeah. We're living in those apartments in Utule, across from the yacht club and the government building and all that.
Yeah.
Right next to just down the street from Shimasaki's. I got a baseball glove for Christmas, and I loved it, dude. I loved it. There wasn't those apartments down there had a big cement wall on each end, and we lived on the end, and I would throw that baseball against that wall for it seemed like forever. And it would bounce back and either pop fly or bounce
back.
Wait,
and you knew what baseball was at that time, at that young age?
Oh, yeah. Of course I knew what baseball was. But, but I had a glove now. It was a real deal if I had a glove, And I would just catch that ball for hours, And, back then, you didn't have TV. You had three channels and, no internet and TV, no TV until like 4:30, 5 o'clock when Sesame Street came on. So I would just sit there and throw that ball against the wall and – but I started playing when I was seven. Is when like Pee Wee, coach pitch, underhand pitch. Pee Wee started that summer, and
that was the first year that Tony kind of opened up the program.
I think that's exactly when it was, because I remember, back then, they had they had like two or three practices with all the kids on the field, and. It was like 50 kids on the field, and he's out there pitching underhand, and everybody's hitting and hitting and hitting. And I remember, I'll never forget this. He was out there pitching, and I was like, second base, shortstop position or something. But, there was a other kids around, but this kid hit this line drive, and every time someone hit a line drive, he'd say, "Nice catch." And he turned around. He turned around, and looked at me, and said, "Nice catch." I was like, "Oh, I'm there." You know.
But what was that like? What was that practice like? With all those kids, were a bunch of kids that had their own gloves? What was the field like? Kind of describe. Did they have shoes?
Well, see, back then it was. This was like 86, 87. So you know, like I said, I had a glove, and that was it. I had the shoes I had were the shoes I had were like Velcro shoes. I mean, had laces. They're just like tennis shoes. You know, there wasn't any cleats or nothing. I don't remember the field being. I mean, it was a field. I mean, as I got older, I remember the field, but I remember that field early. I mean, it was new. I know it was new. So, ain't no telling what the field was as far as I know that older, when we got older, it was rocks. It was, there was patches of lava rock out in the outfield and stuff that was just part of it, there were some big rocks in the infield and stuff later, but that new field, man, I remember like the fence wasn't tall. The bleachers were like, just 2x6s and 2x4s and this and that painted white and, I remember it wasn't much, but it was enough,
Right, it was a field. It was a patch of grass and some rock.
Absolutely. It was four bases and a fence, baby. But everybody went out there and tried out and next thing you know, they split up teams and I was on the Blue Jays, Back in like I said, I think it was 86. 87 was my first two years playing. Me and as far as anybody I know, Jeff Felice played 86 and 87 on the Blue Jays. 7 and 8 years old.
Who was your first coach?
My first coach was Phil Hall. I think he was Roy Hall's brother. He was Phil Hall. And then his son Jeremiah was like the stud of the team. He was the big kid on the team, and we played and practiced and played and practiced and stuff. And I remember back then, on island, you're 25 cents, you could kid could ride a bus anywhere, And
yeah,
I remember we used to have practice at Pongo Park, down in Pongo.
No way, really.
Yeah, we used to have practice at Pongo Park at 4:30, and I would go to practice at like 3:30, just so I'd be early,
Yeah.
So I'd take my little quarter, and I would ride the bus down to practice, but my mom would pick me up after practice, because me and my cousin played on the same team, my cousin Wyatt, and we would be on the same team, and we would go play. I would ride the bus to practice, and they would pick us up when it was over. But it was, like I said, down at Pongo Park, man. Phil Hall was my first. I think his brother Roy Hall is still on island, as a lawyer and all that. So, and then my second year, 87, it was Henry Cespasara. He was a second coach. So. That was 86, 87.
And you were early in elementary, right? That was kind of early elementary. What grade were you?
I think that was second and third grade,
Wow.
Second and third grade, but, 7 and 8 years old. So, yeah, second and third grade. So, on island, there was nothing before that. It was just 6, 7, and 8, and then and then Little League, that was Pee Wee, and then Little League was like 9, 10, 11, 12. So
they had Little League, like older guys playing at the same year when you were playing Pee Wee?
Yeah, they had Little League. From what I remember, it was, like I said, Pee Wee League was like 6, 7, 8. Mm-hmm. And then Little League was 9, 10, 11, 12. And I think that's why I didn't play when I was 9 or 10, because I looked at those 12-year-olds, and as a 9-year-old or 8-year-old, I was like, oh, man, I don't want to play against these guys. They're throwing curveballs, man. I was like, oh, man, this is crazy. So I didn't play again until I was 11. I think my family, we took a trip when I was 10, to the States, and that was, you know, back then that was a big deal.
Right.
But I didn't play when I was 9 or 10, and then picked it up again 11 and 12. That's when I think you and I started playing together against each other and stuff.
Yeah.
But that was so 86. I think 86, 87. And then that was when I started, man. That was back in, like I said, when Tony first came down there and started. But like I said, he looked back at me and said, "Nice catch." And I was like, "Oh man, I'm good." Got a lot of time.
Awesome. So you did the Pee Wee, and then you did a little bit of Little League. And what happened after Little League?
Well, I think Little League for me.
Did that take you right into high school baseball?
It took me into senior league, you know, and it was Little League. It was Pee Wee League, Little League, and Senior League back then. For me, you know, the big thing was, you know, when I started playing at 11, I played and I was good and stuff, but it always seemed like the 12-year-olds were they were going to be the bigger, better players as far as, like, you know, who went on to All-Stars, you know, because I think back then, you know, if you made the All-Stars, that was like the big time, you know, because they went to Guam, they went to Taiwan, they went to Hawaii, wherever else they went, and that was my dream, was to be an All-Star at 12 years old. And I think the big thing for me was, you know, back then, when I was 12, I'll never forget, when I was 11, you know, I think that whole year we didn't have uniforms. You know, we played in t-shirts, we played in t-shirts and shorts and stuff and whatever. And, you know, if you had a pair of baseball pants, you wore it, you know?
Yeah.
But then when I was 12, you know, it was like, I was like, okay, I'm a 12-year-old. Basically you were a pitcher or a catcher because you could throw hard or you could catch. And that's when I started catching. And then I'll never forget, you know, when they had All-Star practice or they announced All-Stars, you know, this was, you know, before internet and email and phone calls, and phone calls were barely, but I remember seeing my coach like on a Thursday, and he said, "Oh yeah, they got practice, All-Star practice tomorrow. You better go." I said, "What?" And, you know, just like passing on the road, you know, and I went, and that was the last day. They were picking the team that day. And I'll never forget, we was out there and hitting fly balls and ground balls and, you know, the normal stuff. And, you know, these are guys that I've been playing with for, you know, a couple, 3 years, and it wasn't anything different. It was just, like, I didn't know, you know. And I remember, like, as soon as that practice was finished, I forget who it was, but they picked the team. And I was, you know, of course, I wasn't picked because that was the first day I went, was the day they picked teams. Man, and everybody left, and I cried, man. I cried and cried and cried in those bleachers, and I said, man, I am not going to let this happen to me again. I'm going to be
– No way.
I'm going to be a player, you know. So that was – like I said, that was – I was 12, you know. And
what grade is 12?
I think at that point it was 7th grade, 6th or 7th grade, you know.
Okay.
I think it was 7th grade. So you're old enough to, you know, to know that, you know, what you kind of want and what feels good to you mentally and what feels good as far as achievement, you know. So to me, that was a big deal, man. I wanted to be an All-Star. I wanted to go to, you know, I think the player that stands out to me is, I think, Isaiah. You know, Isaiah and all them went to Taiwan and, you know, Hawaii and wherever else they went. I was like, man, I want to play there, man. I want to play in Taiwan, you know?
Right.
And
right.
I think that team went to Hawaii that year, and I was devastated. But then after that, it was senior league, which was like 8th grade and senior year, freshman year in high school. And then after that, it was high school ball. So, and national team. So it was, So senior league, it was like, all right, you know, it's the ball's moving faster. It's the same game, but the ball's moving faster. Everybody's running harder, hitting harder, and the ball's, you know, moving faster.
So the national team, you mentioned the national team, and that originated out of the Olympic Committee and was Ray Brown there before the national team, or did he come after?
I think Ray came after the national team got started. I think they saw that the national team was a group of players, and again, I think I was too young for it, but I think I was a freshman maybe in high school, and they had Joe Pritchard, Tula Bucky,
yep,
Solita, Tula Feely, Isaiah, Daniel Lee, Sid Newble, Joe Pritchard, yeah. Who else? Marcus Lankildy. Who else was on that team?
Right,
Willie Satawa, Neil Annandale. You know, all these guys that played, uh-huh, you know, with us later, I think. But anyway, they started that national team. Yeah, I think it was 94, 95 that they had.
And they were the older guys while you were in Pee Wee, and they were like in the little league. Older, exactly, age, right?
And that's who was throwing the curveballs and stuff. So when I was
yeah,
too scared to play at 9 and 10, but they got started, and I think they saw that baseball had some serious potential on it. Looking back,
man, they had some players, boy. They had
absolutely
some studs. Marcus Lankildy. Oh man.
Joe Slavelle, who is played in NFL,
yep,
and all these guys, they were like 2 or 3 years older than me, or us, and I think that they recognized that baseball needed to take that next step, and unfortunately, being on island, you don't have the exposure sometimes, so I think that
yeah,
competition and this and that, but they brought that exposure to the island in Ray Brown, who, as a developmental officer, who brought, a lifetime of baseball to American Samoa, and he brought it to us where, as a developmental officer, I think in our freshman year of high school, to where,
mm-hmm,
this was somebody new, who came on island with his style and his approach and his style, which once you broke the surface, I think he really hit you with baseball knowledge,
Yeah, it was definitely next level, man. It helped to offer structure to the raw talent that
yes,
we have.
Yes, yes.
And I think it was awesome.
Yeah, it was structure, because I remember the first time, one of the first times I had experience with Ray was, hey, 4 o'clock, it's 4 o'clock. we don't get here at 4 o'clock, we start mm-hmm. running at 4 o'clock.
Yep.
That means you're here with your shoes on at 3:30, quarter till, ready to go, and 4 o'clock. That's when you start your lap. That wasn't get to the practice, get to the field at 4 o'clock. It wasn't island time. It wasn't island time.
It was rough to get used to. I know for a lot of us, it was really hard to get accustomed to.
And even me being the Palani kid on the team, but for him to be the outsider Palani coming in, I was like, oh man, he didn't. It was. This was in the mid to late 90s where in our experience, I think coaches told it how it was, hey,
mm-hmm.
get your act together and play and practice and play and practice and play and practice, and there was no, just do whatever, just play and play as good as you can. It was let you know real quick what you were doing wrong, what you did well, what you need to get better at. And that was a constant drive that he instilled, I think, on the practice field and when we did play, that for me, it was hard to accept at times because, like I said, Ray was rough around the edges, but once he realized that you bought in and were committed and had the work ethic on the field, I think it was then you were part of him, And it took me some time to get used to that. you know, I mean, I think anybody maybe, but, you know, there was times I was like, man, how's he going to talk to us like that, you know? And I was like, but wait a minute, you know, he's not wrong. You know, he's just not—he's just not telling us like we—you know—he's not sugarcoating it like, he's not telling you. He's just telling you in a way that he's going to know about, you're going to know about, and guess what? He's yelling, so everybody knows about. You know, I can say honestly now that you know, like I said, when I finally did, you know, somewhat commit to that team and National League and national team, excuse me, you know, it was, he knew that I was a player and was going to be there for the, you know, no matter how much, you know, I needed the practice or needed the work, I was going to be there to get better, you know, that's the way I saw it. So, but yeah, the national team got started and then he came in after it got started to take it to the next level. So.
Yeah. There's one, I saw a post on Facebook where you had the hat from the Best of the West tournament in Hawaii. Do you remember that trip?
Oh, man, I do.
And this was the Masters of Team trip, right?
Yeah.
This was the best of the best from the island, kids that tried out, because a lot of people tried out for the national team, I'm assuming, right?
A lot of kids did try out for the national team, and I think that part of that team is we were so – we had enough for two teams, you know, teams that we were a big enough team that when we did travel, it was, you know, like 30, 35 kids, you know, players.
Yeah.
You know,
And
I think
what was that Hawaii tournament like? What do you remember about that Best of the West tournament?
Well, I remember that, we were there for 2 weeks and the first week
and
we
what,
went around.
What, you, what grade were you? How old were you and what grade? In school you were you when you made that squad?
I just finished my junior year in high school. We practiced that summer and then we went, I still got the t-shirt, man. 1995.
Yeah.
Rainbow Stadium.
Yep.
The t-shirt now. Hey, it still fits sometimes, but not the hat, the t-shirt, you know? No, that was my junior year, summer between my junior and senior year in high school. And I think our team was, we had a lot of players. We had a lot of good players. We had a lot of players that, you know, didn't get exposure. For me personally, like, you know, we played a support role and we were second string. And that was because, you know, the main thing is the best players played, you know, the best nine got on the field. And for me, you know,
that was a big deal, huh? Just to be on that team and to travel, that was a pretty big deal, I remember.
Oh, it was a huge deal, man. We had fundraisers, we had practices and all kinds of stuff going on.
And wasn't the airport packed, you know, on the way out when the team left? Wasn't the airport packed full of people like, oh, you can do it, you know, news and everything?
Yeah, we had, you know, they had reporter, you know, it might have been a reporter or two, or that, you know, get a quick story from a couple players. But, you know, the main thing is, like I said, you know, we were, you know, it was expensive to take a team, 30 players, you know, 40 people total, whatever you want to call it, to Hawaii for 2 weeks, you know. So you had to generate a lot of fundraising and buzz and, you know, to get people to contribute. And, you know, so, but I remember we played high schools for the first week. And then we played the tournament the second week. And I remember we traveled to, where did we travel? We traveled to Kahuku. We traveled to, I think, Mililani. You know, we traveled around Oahu and played some very good teams. But like I said, you know, for me personally, you know, I didn't get to play in the tournament. I didn't get to play very much in that week before. You know, I would go warm up the pitchers in the bullpen as a catcher. And, you know, for me, it was another step of, oh my gosh, what am I doing, man? I'm busting my hump, you know, 6 days a week, sometimes seven. And, you know, I'm playing and playing and practicing and practicing and practicing and practicing and playing and practicing. And it was like, all right, do you want to keep doing this? And the answer was yes. The answer was yes. I wanted to be there for my team. I wanted to be there for my my family that knew I played and this and that. And there's a picture. There's some pictures taken from that team in our last game. I'll never forget. I think we were we were losing, but I'll never forget. They told me, all right, you're hitting. And I was on deck when there was two outs. I was on deck. And I think the guy in front, I think it was Daniel Hunkin. I think he got out. He got out. And I never got to play or bat or anything that whole 2 weeks. And I was like, man, I don't wanna feel like this again, And we shook hands with the other team and we were walking off the field and my mom took a picture from the stands and I was, just walking back with the rest of the team and there's Stanley and Stanley Filianga and Chris Solita and Vili Pauli in the background and Ray and Just Vienna and I had this look on my face and I was 16 years old and just a baseball player and I was and I see the picture now and I was like I was so mad in that picture so mad and I was like man I said do I want to keep doing this I asked myself that a few times and the answer was yes 100% yes because I love this game. I said, I know the problem. The problem is I'm not good enough to get on the field. And that all changed about 6 months later when we went to Australia,
Yeah, and then you made that squad to the first ever Olympic qualifying tournament to another country, which is Australia. And that was in the fall, right? That was in the fall, kind of winter-ish. But it was that same year.
October of 95 and we went to Hawaii that summer and we went Australia that October of 95 and
that was there was a much smaller group
man it was the complete opposite it was it was a complete opposite it was if 30 kids went to 40 kids went to Hawaii 12 or 13 went to Australia, man. It was everybody.
And that was
everybody.
A select group, yeah.
And I don't even. And if that's the case, then I hope that's it because, like I said, I like to think that I made a commitment to it and got better. But I think that the players just we didn't have enough for a team. I mean, I remember we had older players that committed and played and. I remember Ben Solito was going to play with us that year. He did play. He did. There wasn't going to play. He played first base a couple games or something. And it was like, man, but, Ben's playing. This is the real deal. This isn't we need our all out of everybody. When the nine took the field, there was three on the bench. It was, hey, you're going to be played where you get asked to play, told to play, I remember I played DH, catcher, and right field that series.
And that was a big deal because the competition was much, a lot more elite because you're challenging the national team for Australia, right? And you're challenging the national team for New Zealand. It wasn't just like, regular high school kids that played. It was actually the best of the best from other countries tournament.
I think to this day, and again, this is just me thinking, I think this might have been the first time, one of the first times that American Samoa left and won in international competition in anything, netball, volleyball, basketball, anything, we ate steak that night after our first victory against New Zealand. Russ bought us all steaks. I mean, it was a big deal. and we everybody thinks of New Zealand as a big. They had a team, but New Zealand isn't baseball at the time wasn't big in New Zealand. But they got a million people that live there. I'm sure they could find nine to put on a baseball field. and Australia is. Australia had baseball equivalent to AAA in the state, and they had they had a national team. You know, they had major leaguers that, that played, you know, in the states for, you know, that came off of that national team. And that was the first time I think I saw a baseball moving 90 miles an hour plus. And I didn't know baseball. I didn't know baseball could hiss like that when it went past you. You know. But I think that you know, the biggest thing, you know, was we weren't intimidated. You know, we weren't intimidated. I remember, I'll never forget, you know, when we flew, we went from Samoa to Western Samoa to New Zealand to Australia. And when we went from Western Samoa to New Zealand, you know, we were reading, there was an article in that magazine on Polynesian Airlines about the Kiwi team, you know, the Kiwi baseball team from New Zealand. And we're like, oh man, you know, this is us, you know, we're, and we're like, oh man, they're talking about the, you know, read this, you know, we all kind of like talked and said, oh, read it, read it. Well, there was like a 3-page article about it, you know, how the Kiwis were going to, you know, play against the Australians and give them a run for their money. And like the last paragraph that said, also participating, American Samoa. Hey, and I think we, I don't know about everybody else, but I read that and I said, no. We've come too far for this, man. We're gonna get some respect out of this place, and you know, in pure New Zealand fashion, you know, as awesome as it is, you know, they did the haka against Australia. Right. And they got, and you know, we sat there and watched that game, so we knew it was coming. And then, you know, they got beat pretty bad, but then they were going to play us next. And I think, you know, the coaches said, hey, you know, we need to be ready for their haka. So we got ready and we did one back. Hey, to this day, I still talk about that. I said, hey, we answered. Okay. And that first game, I think we won 13-11 or 13-12. And, you know, after that, it was we that was our first victory. And then it was like 7-5 and then 8-2 or whatever it was. So we beat New Zealand. But at the same time, we got better against Australia.
Yeah.
If they kicked our teeth in that first game, with each game, they realized quickly that they were playing against people that could play. So if it was like 1-0 in the fifth inning, that was a big deal. You know, their coaches were coaching. You know, they were coaching their asses off. You know, against these 12 kids from American Samoa who knew what they were doing. And like I said, I think Ray joined us that trip as well. In fact, I know he did. And you know, he took us to that next level. I think as far as, all right, Ray's here. You know, he can tell us. He can get us to channel. It's weird because he could get us to, like, you know, by yelling at us and stuff in his own way. And we all laughed at him at the same time, you know. He could get us to act right and do right on the field. And damn it, we kicked New Zealand's ass, and we played our asses off against Australia. And to this day, that is the proudest athletic event of my life. You know, next is coaching my sons in baseball now, but right there is number one. So. That was
what would you say is the impact that baseball has had in your life, like growing up and then with who you are today and how you're instilling in your family and in your kids? Like, what impact has baseball had on you?
Man, I think the main thing is when you play as competitive as we did. Coming from a small island, you know, the best play, you know, the best nine are going to be on the field. And if something happens that the best nine aren't, well, guess what? The next man up is going to be on there. You know, the next one up is going to be on there. And if you get in a situation where your name is called then you need to perform. You need to perform, mm-hmm. and I think that's, you know, that's true in life. You know, as I think our generation, you know, as late 30s, early 40s, whatever we are now, that, you know, that was the last part of society, I think, that had that, you know. It's like, you know, you sit down because you're not good enough. You're playing because you are good enough. You know, there was that dynamic on the field that told you how it was, you know, and you know, whether you have a job, you know, like you get, you know, with your job, you get paid accordingly. You get paid more if you do better, and raises and this and that, you know, and if your family, you know, you know, if you're accountable to your family, just same way you're accountable to your teammates, you know, it's huge. You know, it's huge. I think any team sport like that you stay with, you know, can have contributions down the line in life, you know, tenfold, you know, and, you know, if you're, that's one thing we always talk about on the field, you know, after the game was what we did right, what we did wrong, what we need to do better, you know, and,
right.
And, yeah, we always talked about
it. And then your 50 push-ups, your 100 sit-ups.
And that was my thing, man. Hey, listen, that was why I wasn't good enough, you know, because I tried to, like, skimp, you know, on that. I tried to cut corners and do, you know, a few here and a few there and think that, you know, no one was looking. Well, guess what?
Mm-hmm.
That's why my ass rode the bench sometimes, you know, and I said, oh, man, I said, this needs to change. And you know, that was my downfall. I think that, you know, I know that, you know, you personally, you know, my example of you is I said, you know, you might not have been the strongest person on the field. You couldn't throw the furthest, but goddamn it, no one's going to outwork Robert Penny. You know, I remember we had our first field day. We're out there pulling weeds and raking grass and this and that. And, you know, and there's Robert Penny out there at second base picking up rocks. And you stayed at second base picking up rocks. I'm like, why is he picking up rocks? He's like, because he don't want any bad ground balls at second base. I was like, oh, man, that's, you know, that's something right there, you know. And, hey, I can say that, you know, if I had better drive, or I had, you know, a motor in me mentally like you did then, you know, I would have gone a lot further. You know, I think, you know, trying to walk on to a Division I college and they say, yeah, we know you can play, but, you know, you're not good enough to be better than anybody we already have as a walk-on. So thanks for coming, you know, as a D1 tryout, you know, that was it. You know, you got to have drive. So, yeah, that's how it reflects in life, man. I mean, life isn't easy, and when you get, you know, tested on the field mentally or physically, but especially mentally, same thing.
So. Right. That's good, man. You can instill that into your kids, man. You know, to persevere and stay loyal to your team and keep working hard and stuff. So
I tell you right now, but you know that my youngest son is my baseball player. My oldest son, he doesn't play as much as I'd like him to or whatever. But at the same time, I'm their dad, you know. So I don't want to scare him off the field. But I can tell you that about 3 or 4 weeks ago, we had a game where my son, he wanted to play pitcher, and we were very, very, the game was close. And everybody we had everywhere in position-wise was working out, and he liked to catch. So I had him a catcher, and then I moved him to the outfield. But he wanted to play pitcher. Well, my pitcher was doing a great job as far as, you know, it's machine pitch, so he was doing a great job. I said, no, you go in the outfield. You know, I've got to tell my son this now, right? Well, he gets mad at me after the game, and this is our, you know, this is our victory. You know, we win eventually, And I said, son, listen, I've got to do things for the team. Okay, I can't do things to make you happy. And this is a five. Yeah, I'm telling this to a 5.5-year-old. You know,
who is
playing. No, first of all, he's playing with 7 and 8-year-olds. Okay,
Wow.
He's five, and he's playing with 7 and 8-year-olds. He's going from catcher. He wants to play pitcher, but I stick him in outfield because another kid was also a catcher, and our pitcher was doing great, you know, defensively. And I said, son, I got to do what's best for the team. And he went out there pouting, and, you know, he was all musu about everything. And I said, right now I'm your coach. But in the back of my mind, of course, I was his father. But in the moment, I had to be his coach, you know. And I have to, right now, there's a kind of a delicate line of being a coach and a dad at the same time. And, you know, you want to do what's best for your kid, but you also, at the same time, got to remember the team. And, you know, you got to make those decisions. And like I said, it was telling a five-year-old, no, you can't play pitcher. You have to play in the outfield.
Yeah.
So.
The joys of parenthood. The joys of parenthood.
Man, I tell you, they like I said, so you can be mad at me later, but guess what? There's 10 other kids out here that are wanting to play pitcher too, you know. And right now, I've got to put people where they need to be, where it gives us the best chance to win, you know. And you know, I've coached T-ball, and then what they call a rookie. Where they have machine pitch, and I tell the kids as soon as they move up, I say, listen, this isn't T-ball anymore. We're not playing with the grass. We're not playing in the dirt. The ball's harder. It's moving faster. So get ready. You know, and that's and like you said, you know, you move up and the ball's moving faster. Everybody's a little bit faster and stronger. And
right,
you just get ready. But yeah, that's
awesome, dude.
Yeah, telling a 5-year-old that no, I need you to go where I tell you to go, and not where you want to go, because in T-ball you can do that, you know. But you know, as you know, we were that was our only win of the season. I'll say that was our only win. But we were very competitive. We probably got really beaten in like three games, but everything else we were competitive. Mm-hmm. And it came down to, I think what Ray Brown used to tell us, hey, you can't play catch, you can't play baseball.
You know? Yeah.
Hey, guess what? You missed the ball and 3 runs score. You missed the ball and 2 runs score. You missed the ball, and now there's a runner on third instead of 2 outs. You know, and I say, hey, we got to throw it, we got to hit it, we got to catch it, okay? And I put kids on the spot, you know, and say, hey, that's why you're not doing this. You got to give him his good throws. You know, you can't throw it over his head. You can't throw it, you know, in the dirt. You got to throw it to his chest. You know, and I think a little bit of accountability there for kids that age is a good thing, you know. And
you got to stick to the basics.
Even practice. I can tell you that right. Round is, you know, you do base running. And rounding bases, guess what? You miss a base, everybody goes again. Everybody goes again.
Right.
You know, and I say,
get
hey,
him early.
Little Johnny bought this round. Who's next? You know, don't miss the base. I remember if we missed a base or hit a foul ball, guess what? It was next. Who's next? You know, you lost your turn.
Right.
You know, so, and definitely, you know, between the practices and the game, you know, all that stuff we learned on the field is, you know, just for me personally, carries over a whole lot, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Dude, this has been good, man. It's been fun just reminiscing and then hearing your story and, you know, some of the things that I wasn't aware of. And I'm sure, you know, a lot of your story is what a lot of people are not aware of, but I think it's going to bring some pretty good awareness to the sport in general. So I appreciate you, man. This has been good. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Is there anything that I didn't ask that you wanted to share?
Man, I remember, like I said, we played against each other, and you know, we had whoever played baseball on island. I think, unfortunately, you know, the good side and the bad side. The good side is you stayed tight and you stayed friends and you stayed. You know, with Little League and whatever league we played in, you know, you stayed competitors. But then when it came to the national team, you played together. But that was almost our downfall in that we didn't have on island, we didn't have the exposure to other teams and other you know, just recognition and exposure to other teams that we could play against to get better. You know, we played against ourselves, yeah. And we had some players, but guess what? Everybody got used to everybody, and we had to, you know, shake it up as best we can, you know, that the coaches did, I'm sure. But when it came time for exposure and practice and stuff, I think that was the only thing that really hamstrung us was not having the ability to play other teams that were as good or better than we were, you know, to get better, to hone our skills and whatnot. But, you know, for an island of 70,000 people, whatever it is, man, we put together a squad that could compete, you know. I'm still proud to this day of, you know, having the uniforms that I still have of those teams, you know.
And, yeah, absolutely.
Being able to play on those teams. And, you know, like I said, I learned a lot about, you know, myself and how to be a productive, just like a teammate and a person and a man in general, you know. Mm-hmm. On the field, on and off the field. So,
good, man.
But yeah, like I said, it was it was a good time, you know, and growing up in it and living it, and, you know, to this day, it allows me to. You know, I remember that I think my senior year when we played Australia at home in Samoa in 96.
Yeah.
You know, we had to coach a little league team.
Right.
You know, that was part of it was coaching a little league team. And
yeah.
And I'm not gonna say any names, but Crystalita didn't help me out very much. you know, with our Bank of Hawaii team, you know, so I had to learn how to coach all these 7 and 8 year olds by myself. And I loved it. I was nervous at first, but you know, you get out there and you practice, and these kids are probably 25, 30 years old now, you know, and
yeah,
I like to hope that I had some sort of influence on them to. I think there was a kid, Terrence Apter. He was, I think he was a lineman for USC or something. He was a big kid, and when he was 8,
oh, wow.
I know that. And like he threw so hard, he could only catch. He couldn't pitch because no one could catch him. You know, and like I said, he was a great kid, and you know, these kids were just great kids, man. But that's allowed me to take the next step and to coach my kids. You know, it's a bit, you know,
right,
be able
right,
to,
right.
if you can coach a dozen 6, 7, 8 year olds, whatever age they are, more power to you, because that's where you need the volunteers and stuff in little league and football and whatever the case is. You know, you need those volunteers, and you need people that, you know, not only know what they're doing, but help kids get better every day. I mean, you may look like the Bad News Bears stepping on the field, but you're going to look like the Good News Bears stepping off the field. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's...
this is good, man. Thank you. I appreciate you.
Hey, Rob, thank you, man. Like I said, you know, you brought up a lot of memories for me and feelings and stuff like that
yeah.
I haven't, you know, thought about in a while. And, you know, it's just good to reminisce. And like I said, it shapes who you are, you know. It shapes who you are off field and on the field, and you know, hopefully it helps you become a more productive person. But I can say that, you know, a lot of our coaches, you know, Ray Brown, especially Ben Solita, you know, mm-hmm. Gus Viena, Mike, Manny, Mike, all the Peter, you know, all those guys.
Peter
Michelangelo.
Yeah,
you know, and he played ball with us too in Australia, man. But you right. know, our coaches, man, they like I said, they held us accountable for what we were doing or not doing it. And you know, I think that if you try to sugarcoat a lot of things in life, then they unfortunately they can, you know, resurface as bad things down the road. But you know, when you're accountable right. to yourself and your teammates and your team as a whole, it helps out tremendously, you know. And you know, I think everybody on that field was put on the spot at some point, you know, to themselves and the team.
Yeah.
Good, bad, or ugly. You know, good, bad, or ugly. And, you know, that was good. That was good. That was good. 100%, man. That was good.
Oh, man. So, what great memories. Great memories.
Yeah, man. But just the experiences, man. The experiences of going off island and traveling and playing and, you know, the jokes and the hanging out and all kinds of stuff, man. Just you know, never mind the baseball, but, you know, a lot of us, you know, I think through social media, especially Facebook and whatnot, we all keep together and, you know, stick together and keep in touch and check in on everybody's family and friends and moms and dads. And unfortunately, you know, life happens and, you know, we're there for each other when things do happen, it's good and bad. And it all started on that field, man.
Yep, all on that field, man. And that's the goal with all this stuff is to cement the stories and make it available to people so they can always revisit it. Because a lot of the things that other people know about you that you've been close to, you know, we don't. So by allowing you to share and allowing other people to share, it just, you know, adds more color to the story and fills in gaps where it needs to be filled. So this has been great, man. I appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
And
you're
everybody else that's going to listen to it is going to appreciate it too.
And there was, like I said, the last thing I'll say is there's a lot of good players that came off that field, man. A lot of you guys went on to college, play ball in college. I think a couple went to play. You know, I'll never forget. I was calling when I found out Ted Gebauer played. Baseball in Pensacola, you know, and I live close to Pensacola now, but when I was at school in Auburn, I called, West Florida is where the Pensacola Pelicans practice. And I called, and I called the school one time, you know, athletic department, and they said, okay, well, this is his number, such and such. So I called the baseball coach and they're like, well, he's on the field. Here's his cell number. And I said, oh, okay, I'll call his cell number. And I called his cell number and he answered. And I said, Coach, I'm sorry to bother you, but I'm looking for Ted Gebauer. Is he around you? He said, oh yeah, he's over here warming up in right field. I said, I'm his buddy from American Samoa. Can I talk to him? And me and Ted had a quick conversation. He's like, okay, I got to go practice.
No way, dude. That's crazy.
Yeah, man. And I never.
He didn't even tell us you called.
Man, I never made it down to see him in Pensacola. But like I said, he goes, how'd you get this number? I said, I called around.
That is funny.
Yeah, man. So it was like I said, it was cool to check in with somebody who had kind of made it, you know. And it was it was neat.
You know, me and Stan were on. We were on the same team. We all played there together.
In Pensacola?
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Really?
Me and Ted were roommates. Yeah. Yeah, man. That's crazy. Well, we'll talk. You'll hear the story. You'll hear the story after I talk to Ted, and then how they got signed and how all that stuff. It was crazy. Just the journey there. It's an incredible story, man. It's an incredible
story.
But you'll get to hear it on his episode. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
But Ted, you know, in Australia, man, we sit there and make jokes about how fast we were striking out against the Australian pitcher. It's like, oh, here we go, 1, 2, 3.
Oh man.
I'll never forget. That was the first time we ever played. We didn't have to go chase the ball in the woods or anything because they always.
Oh yeah.
They had plenty of baseballs for us.
Man, we used to fight over those foul balls.
Yeah, man, because it was like, it was, you know, if you went and got it, I think it was your turn to hit if you went and got it, you know. So
yeah.
If you hit it, you had to, you know, switch, but if you went and got it, it was your turn. But no, man, it's just like you said, so many memories, man. So many memories that start on that field that, you know, lead up to, you know, a lot of who we are now. Absolutely.
All right.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, good deal,
anyway,
man. I won't keep you too much more longer.
No, hey, like I said, like, ask away, man. Whatever you need from me, man. It's been a pleasure as far as telling you, you know, about, you know, how it related to me and my experiences and whatnot. But you know, I think it's just the ability to have the opportunity to get on the field and play a sport that allows you to become a better person. As well as a better athlete, but a better person is the main thing. So,
yep. At the end of the day, that's what it's about. So, all right, man. All right, dude.
Robert, hey, you take care of yourself, my friend. I'm glad I started you on this path of baseball, man. You can thank me, right?
Yes. Yeah. My episode, I'll definitely talk about the stinking Falangi, man.
that time you came out to watch your boy play, huh?
Yeah.
I never forget you and your mom and your sister. I was up there in the stands in the red and white Montefiore uniform watching me play. I was like,
yeah. That was awesome, dude. That was awesome. I'm like,
hey, Rock, hey, you can sign up next year, man. It's cool.
Yeah. Not this year, buddy. Next year.
hey, you're going to get your $15 and sign up next time. It's cool.
Oh man, that's awesome.
Like, you just watch me hit this ball and cheer for me, okay?
Yeah.
Oh man.
Oh, the good old days. Anyway. What the foul. All right,
absolutely.
Dude.
Absolutely. Robbie, hey, good talking, man. My friend. Take care, Uso, and hey, you got a beautiful family, my friend. Take care of them, okay?
Cool. You too, dude. Okay.
All right, dude. See you. All right, bye.
All right.